CTV Dialogues, a special CNS series, insightful and thought-provoking conversations with leaders to accelerate progress towards ending TB. This series underpins the urgency to step up the fight against the epidemic. We have 135 months left to end the pandemic globally by 2030, and only 75 months left to end it in India. Our country has committed to end it by 2025. New and fresh thinking is vital to reimagine every critical cog in the wheel to end TB, as well as to accelerate progress towards other sustainable development goals. This episode of NTB Dialogues features a very special guest, Dr. Ishwar Gilada, who was among the first Indian doctors who began HIV medical care when the first HIV case was diagnosed in the country. Dr. Gilada is the president of the AIDS Society of India, which is a nationwide network of HIV medical experts and scientists. And he is elected member of the Governing Council of the International AIDS Society, or IAS, as it is commonly known as. He is also part of the Technical Working Group of on Latent TB Infection. Welcome, Dr. Gilada.
Thank you.
Are gains made in the fight against AIDS being lost to TB? You and other HIV experts are helping people living with HIV to stay alive and lead normal lives. But many of them die of a disease that is preventable and curable, that is tuberculosis. Can you please share your reflections on this?
We started working in the field of HIV since 85, and we started seeing our first cases in 85 December. And thereafter, when actually the patients were dying, they were not dying of HIV. In 88, we established the first indigenous HIV case who died of, she was a sex worker and she died of tuberculosis. And when the postmortems were done, the controversy arose that it is not HIV, it is tuberculosis. And we said that the patient of HIV is dying of opportunistic infection, that is tuberculosis. All over the world, people at that time were saying that in most of the countries, there were that time PCP pneumonia was very common. And we said that in India, opportunistic infections are so common. Even those people who are not immunodeficient or immunocompromised, they also get those infections. So when tuberculosis has been there in India, in common general population, when there are immunodeficient people, it will be definitely more than what it was there in the general population. But it was to be established, and we could establish that. And thankfully, Dr. K.C. Mohanty, who is no more now, but he was a veteran TB specialist, and he was the only TB specialist in the country at that time who agreed to do surveillance of HIV in TB patients. Because we were looking at tuberculosis in HIV patients, but after they were sick with tuberculosis in HIV. But if you look at HIV prevalence in TB patients, you will find the other way around also. So we, from both sides, in TB, what is HIV prevalence? And in HIV, what is the TB prevalence? We started studying together. And we established that TB is in a very big way. It was a simple calculation was that people with HIV have chances of getting tuberculosis 10 times more than their other counterpart. However, in the last few years, the very good treatment of HIV has come. But what happens is that treatment is available to only those people which are diagnosed or detected with HIV. And those who have reached to ART centers and those who have faith of taking regular ART, then they do not get tuberculosis or any other opportunistic infections. However, the human tendency is such that once you start feeling a little better, you stop treatment. And in HIV, you have to take lifetime treatment. So when you stop, stay, again you stop, then there are more chances of getting tuberculosis. All over the world, people gathered and they decided that we should end tuberculosis by 2030. But our Prime Minister, Mr. Narendra Modi, is a little bit ahead of people. And he declared that we would like to end the tuberculosis in India by 2025. So that is 5 years ahead of the entire world. And in 1/6 of the world's population, which is supposed to be a developing country. So it is a big challenge. But if you take such kind of challenges and you take those kind of steps to meet those challenges, Nothing is impossible. Oh, in LTBI, that is latent tuberculosis infection, where also a member of that committee of Government of India, we had looked at that not only acute tuberculosis patients should be treated, but we should try to diagnose latent tuberculosis and what are the tools available. So currently, not many tools are available. The simple test, which is a PPD or a tuberculin test, which is no more significant, no more use as a common marker. And the other tests, which are supposed to be gold tuberculosis test and other tests, they are not user-friendly. They are expensive. So we are looking at only markers, which are soft markers, of contact tracing of people of tuberculosis open cox or pulmonary tuberculosis. They may be sputum positive or sputum negative. Those people, they should be provided a course of TB prevention. And TB prevention is not TB treatment. So TB treatment, we require four type of different medicines for at least 2 to 3 months, and then you can come down to 2 medicines. But in prevention, it can be either a simple course of isoniazid to be taken for 6 months, or it can be rifapentin with isoniazid once a week for 12 weeks. And it can be also rifampicin with isoniazid for 2 or 3 months daily. So there are three different, there are many algorithms, but there are three different algorithms which are checked. And Government of India is on the verge of opening up to rifapentin. Rifapentin is one of the newer drug, and it is less toxic than rifampicin, and it could be more effective because rifampicin once a week will not work, but rifapentin once a week along with isoniazid will work. And they have found the results which are similar, whether you have taken once a week rifampicin isoniazid for 12 weeks, that is only 12 doses, or you have taken 90 doses of 180 doses of isoniazid, that is one daily for 180 days, or you have taken one tablet of rifampicin when isoniazid for 3 months daily. So results were similar. So we are looking at who should be called contacts, number one. Number two, in HIV positive people, everybody should be given. Number three, those which are below 5, everybody should be given. So below 5, everybody is given. Above 5, only immunocompromised people, including HIV patients, should be given. And other than that, we should look at the contacts. So this is a big challenge before the community, which is working to stop tuberculosis or to eliminate tuberculosis. And our revised National TB Control Program and Central TB Division of Government of India, they said, you give us the guidelines and program and action is our department, we'll look after. So we do not want to take all the challenges on us. We experts are going to only guide what is to be done, which drug to be used. And fortunately, on that committee, there is a Food and Drug Administration representative or CDSCO representative. So fast tracking, getting license, getting clearances, that has been done fantastically. And between the two meetings, we had one meeting about 4 or 5 months back, and now there is a lot of headway already. So rather than being regressive, saying that India is a developing country, how can we be ahead of the whole world, how can we contain tuberculosis by 2025, we should be progressive, and we should take proactive steps. And if it is done, when you are targeting in a big way, you may not achieve the target by 2025, but 26, 27 will not be very far from that. But everything is in, mechanism is in place. There is no dearth of money. Prime Minister has assured the entire country or the tuberculosis program and experts that you tell us what is required and we'll provide. And if that kind of political will is there and that kind of programming on the other hand is there, then we experts should only guide and see everything in a positive perspective rather than putting folks in there.
That's right. For the rollout of TB preventive therapy among people living with HIV, why not test and treat? Do you think that is going to improve adherence to therapy, which spans over months as of now? Or what is your take on it?
You're saying test and treat in HIV?
Yes, I'm talking in HIV.
Yeah. So you see, test and treat, very good strategy. Initially, we were of the proponent because the ARTs were in very small number, not many drugs were available, and it was also a costly affair. So we used to say that in such a situation where everybody cannot afford ARV, you should wait and watch till your immunity is working, and when your immunity is down, you should start ARV. So we made a criteria of 200 CD4 count, then 250 CD4 count, 350 CD4 count, 500 CD4 count. But then there are studies all over the world which are multicentric trials, and they proved that those people who started HIV treatment immediately versus those people who started at 500 or 350 CD4 count, there has been a huge difference in outcome of results. If you started treatment earlier, that is test and treat strategy, you tested positive, you started treatment, then in those cases, not only opportunistic infection related to HIV, but they were not even getting NSDs or non-infectious diseases or heart problem or brain problem or other issues. So when they decided that if we can save people from those infection or diseases which are not infectious diseases, that will be helpful to humankind. And therefore, test and treat has come, and I'm glad that India has also signed that. And from 28th April 2017, though it has been signed on that day, it took little time to start. But now it is test and treat policy. And in that 1 year period, earlier we used to have about 10 lakh people or 1 million people on treatment. Over the year of almost 15 years, like 2004 onwards to 2018, in 1 year, half of those people are added again. So now we have 1.5 million people on treatment. I think this is a very good strategy. And when we are benefiting the entire world with ARVs from India, why should we consume it for our own people?
Okay. What about testing and treating latent TB in people living with HIV? Rather than just giving them TB, the preventive treatment.
Yeah, mandate of our group, which is LTBI group in RNTCP, is the same. But as I told you, not many testing tools are available.
Okay.
So when you test and you find, you are definitely going to treat. But if you are not finding and there's a positive contact in the family or household or office world, that person also should be treated with LTBI guideline for TB prevention. So for TB, test and treat. For non-TB, but context of the TB patient, test and treat for LTBI. And in HIV positive and less than 5, everybody to be put on LTBI. How often it should be repeated, those things are being debated.
Okay. What are the current WHO recommended tests for latent TB which are available? And you said there are limitations. So which is the best test as of now? Or no, but none of them are best?
You see, to speak broadly, in tuberculosis, not much research has been done. Not many molecules were made available. In 30 years, we just got 2 new molecules. Unlike in HIV, in 30 years, we got 24 molecules. So, and therefore, secondly, TB has been always seen as a disease of developing countries and disease of poor people in developing countries. So when you talk about poor countries and poor people in the developing countries, then they do not get priority. And that's the reason that we do not have many of the TB tests. What TB tests are available? When there's a sputum, at least we can do sputum AB, you can do gene expert test. Those tests are available. But when sputum productive person is not there, or open cox is not there, well, how do you treat? Where do you get tissue from? Which tissue you should test? So in that, you should have other markers like tuberculosis test or MONTU test. But MONTU test, again, that doesn't guide you properly. Because there is only one company which was making that PPD in India. Even they are not standardizing. They are asking some help from government. So we need to put all those, plug those holes. And secondly, this tuberculin gold test, that is expensive. Lab test, urine lab test is likely to come. Again, that is expensive. So, unless until cost comes down, there is one new test is going to be developed, which is being developed by Serum Institute of India. And that cost will be around 25 or 30 rupees to 50 rupees. So, So that test will be amenable and that will be within the reach of people. So currently the program is going to look at how easily and how fast that test could be adopted.
Okay, which means we need better diagnostic tests for particularly latent tuberculosis. Yeah. Doctor, every person who is living with HIV.
Which one?
First, is that right? And then that latent TB gets converted.
No, you are saying in HIV patient?
Retroactive TB later? Is that right? Yes. Means first, HIV. Yes.
Exactly what we have been doing since 1994-95 at our clinical setting in Mumbai is that every patient is checked every 6 months for X-ray chest, 1-2 test. 1-2 test we have discontinued just last 1 year before. And also history taking and CBC, complete blood count and sedimentation rate. Based on those things, if we think patient has clinical tuberculosis, treat that patient has clinical tuberculosis with the full term dose. If the patient is not having any of the parameters which are putting the patient into the category of clinical tuberculosis, then treat tuberculosis in that patient by using rifampicin and isoniazid for 60 days or 90 days. And we started repeating that every 2 years, but we were monitoring patient for every 6 months. What we found that over the 24 years of, we are in 25th year now, over the 24 years of follow-up, those people which were given TB prevention treatment with rifampicin and isoniazid, 2 to 3 months every 2 years, very few of them are getting tuberculosis. We will validate that data, we'll try to publish something. But we don't have comparison because all our patients we are going to they were treated with the same algorithm. So we need to have a comparable data that say out of 6,000 patients, if we have prevented tuberculosis in these people because of rifampicin isoniazid, what is another comparison of 6,000 people of similar nature and similar background without prophylaxis? That we have to do comparison.
Okay, LTBI, whether it is in the general population or in the people living with HIV, the preventive therapy has to be repeated. It is not a once in a lifetime thing, is it? Like yeah. For us to understand that supposing a person is given a TB preventive therapy, that has to be repeated after some time, is it?
Yeah. So currently, the understanding is that it should be repeated every 2 years. But there is no one opinion on that. Even in isoniazid prophylaxis, the previous recommendation was to be given isoniazid prophylaxis for 36 months. And probably we have miserably failed in doing that.
Have I lost you? I'm not
for 36 months. Okay. So after the Botswana study, after other 2-3 studies, they came down to 6 months on rifampicin isoniazid for 12 doses or rifampicin isoniazid for 3 months.
Okay.
So all these are doable and people can follow this kind of algorithm, not lengthy.
Okay.
But every 6 months you should check. And if you feel that it should be repeated after after 2 years or 3 years or 1.5 years, you should do that. But every 6 months, if you are giving for 6 months and then after 6 months again you are checking again giving for 6 months, that will become unending prophylaxis. That is not.
Okay. Ensuring better implementation of infection control practices will require healthy people to perceive themselves at risk of disease, which is very difficult. Even those who are sick don't take treatment and medicine. In terms of ending TB, how can we encourage healthy people to opt for voluntary latent TB testing and treatment?
You see, this requires a major public awareness campaign, number one. Number two, healthy people do take vaccines. Healthy children do take vaccine. Why do we give vaccine? To prevent diseases. Vaccine is injectable. Here it is oral. So oral is easier than injectable. So unless and until people have that kind of concept of preventive health, promotive health, that kind of awareness has to be built up in people. And fortunately, in the last 2-3 years, there has been a great awareness about tuberculosis in common people. Sometimes it's called a blessing in disguise. Had MDR TB not come, that kind of awareness may not have come. Had XDR or extremely Western TB did not come, there could not have been so much attention and so much research on tuberculosis, what has happened in the last 2 to 3 years. So it has happened as a blessing in disguise, and because of that, people are scared. We also see in our clinic, when people come with tuberculosis, their family members come, and when we find MDR-TB, we tell them, it's not that we are going to withdraw our support to them, but we tell them that if you continue to get this kind of diseases or MDR-TB, and you continue to be irregular, nobody will check you, nobody will treat you, no doctors would want you to be in the clinic. And then they're scared. The family members also start telling them the same thing, that if doctor doesn't treat you, or hospital doesn't take you, where do you go? There's still a problem today that none of the private hospitals in Mumbai, they would take MDR tuberculosis for admission. Nobody wants them to be admitted in their hospital. So they become only liability or dumping yard for the public hospitals. So there is a problem with MDR tuberculosis. So I believe that we should use that as a tool to create larger awareness that if we don't want MDR TB, we would be regular, we should be regular for TB treatment. If TB treatment is given regularly, and TB is also prevented in society, TB can be wiped out. So it will be backtracking from MDR-TB to healthy people.
What is the role of the non-health sectors in TB control? Are they integrating TB in their agenda? TB as well as latent TB?
You are seeking the help of non-health sector.
Yes.
You see, a non-health sector does a better job than a health sector. Because health sector think that we are busy in our own ways and our own programs. But non-health sector, particularly celebrities like, say, Bollywood personality or Amitabh Bachchan coming and talking about tuberculosis, Anil Kapoor coming and talking about tuberculosis, or political leader talking about that, the religious leader talking about that, sports people talking about that, they have better and greater following than medical people. There are some people who only follow medical advice or from medical people. But there are more number of people who follow the advice of their so-called icons. Icons can be political icon, religious icon, spiritual icon. And if we try to convince those icons and they, out of their discourses, out of their talks, out of their one-liners, say something about tuberculosis, I think that can create a great awareness. And I think that is being done, but it can be further fortified.
Okay. TB and HIV programs have been working together since several years now. Can you suggest any ways if they can work better to ensure that no person living with HIV gets latent TB or even TB and dies of TB? In what better way can they coordinate?
You see, basically, we have been wanting to have a convergence of TB and HIV departments or National TB Program and National HIV Program, that is NACO Program. Convergence has happened to some level. I wouldn't say that it is more than 10 or 15% because only head of the NACO is also head of the RNTCP. But below that, that pyramidal structure is yet to have proper convergence. Unless and until that convergence is done, it will be difficult. What has recently happened is one good thing is that from the ART centers, there is also outlet of giving TB treatment. So rather than giving only ART, they are also able to provide TB treatment. From the TB clinics, they are being screened for HIV and they are being referred to ART center. However, when the proper convergence is done, then rather than having vertical programs for HIV, vertical program for TB, vertical program for hepatitis B and C, they will be all together. If they are all together, there could be some experts which are having expertise only in one particular field. But a common person, program person, ART officer can be ART TB officer. And he or she can do both the jobs. And they can do those jobs more efficiently. Secondly, when somebody has come for HIV testing at ICTC, Integrated Testing and Counseling Center, they are being also screened for hepatitis B, hepatitis C, syphilis. But if you are only looking at from an eye of HIV and putting that people and linking them for treatment for HIV, and you are not looking at other aspects of STD, then that will be an injustice to the person. So therefore, there has to be a program where hepatitis B negative person should be given hepatitis B vaccine. The vaccine is available at pittance of the cost, less than $1 per dose. And in program, it can be further cheaper. Hepatitis C is completely curable. Syphilis is completely curable. But there are problems with those diseases where there is very poor linkages. Secondly, for syphilis treatment, penicillin is not easily available. Wherever penicillin is available, there are no doctors who are willing to give penicillin. And without penicillin, syphilis doesn't recover or doesn't get treated properly. There are drugs like doxycycline or azithromycin, but they are not very potent. So, unless until this knowledge and the tools are together, and they are also part of the entire program, I think we will be neglecting one program and highlighting one program, and that should not happen. Same thing happened in the national programs where initially HIV program got a major boost. Tuberculosis was at low level. HIV became a Department of AIDS in Government of India. After 2-3 years of success, they realized that it is futile to have a Department of AIDS. So they stopped the Department of AIDS, that again became a part of ministry. At the same time, tuberculosis became neglected. So there are a lot of MDR-TB, XDR-TB, tuberculosis getting neglected. So national TB program got it became RNTCP. It got more importance. Today, TB program has more importance than HIV. So they are all basically orphan diseases, neglected diseases. One time they will get importance of for some reason, like World AIDS Day, people will talk only AIDS. National TB, they will talk only TB. But they are interlinked. They are sometimes twin infections, though their way of getting infected is different, way of management is different. But they have very good cohesion amongst themselves. So why we human beings should not have cohesion amongst ourselves while working? And that's what integration is built for. So now, HIV program should piggyback on TB and become important. Currently, HIV program is not that important in national program. So we should have two programs together. If B, C can be rolled in, we can again have a thinking and decide what other programs can be put together. Maybe 3-4 programs can be together. And that will be more efficient, like the National Leprosy Control Program. That is a weakest program currently. But they have a lot of establishment. There are a lot of leprosarias there. So you can use those infrastructure facilities for such national programs which are combined, which are converged. So if we utilize human resource and infrastructure facilities which are for different program for one combined program, we'll have much more facilities available. And same like rather than having two different heads of TB and HIV, now there's one head, so you save a lot of cost over there, and still program is not poor. So it can prove that having two different programs with two different heads with two different parallel streams, that was expensive, that convergence program.
Dr. Gilada, you have led from the front on several HIV and human rights related issues also. Now, with a few days left for the 50th Union World Conference on Lung Health to open in India, and just about a month left for the 12th National Conference of AIDS Society of India, that is ASICON 2019, can you please share your key reflections on HIV and TB care and the way forward?
I think a good time has come. I'm not too happy at present, because we have to slog a lot, and even to get on board with union or any meeting for the last 2 years we have been trying. When we want to be on board with union, it is not for a personal glorification or just giving a talk there or having a meeting there. We have been sincerely wanting that the union should work together along with HIV program. Therefore, we have been inviting union also to our national conferences. Similarly, whether it's a NAPCON or TB conferences, we go there and have a session there. When we want to walk 1 mile extra, we expect that the other side also should come a little bit ahead. And therefore, I think this union is a beginning where HIV program or particularly organizations like ASI is getting some importance. I'm not saying a lot of importance, but some importance. However, union program is not able to come to ISICON because at the same time or same dates, there's a conference called NAPCON, which is a National Association of Pulmonologists. So that is a TB conference. And this is unfortunate that we work at cross purposes. We have two different conferences at two different places on the same dates. So how do we divide the human being to go at both the places? So those things, those are challenges, and we need to sort them out probably for the next year or two. They will sort it out.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Gilada. Friends, you were listening to this special episode of NPB Dialogues, a special CNS series presenting thoughtful and thought-provoking interviews with leaders to accelerate progress towards ending TB. Today, we were in conversation with Dr. Ishwar Gilada, President of the AIDS Society of India and member of the Governing Council of the International AIDS Society. Be welcome to share your comments or reflections on this NPB series at www.citizen-news.org. Thanks for listening and stay tuned for the next episode of NPB Dialogues. And thank you, Dr. Gilada.
Thank you. And happy Diwali.
Thank you. Same to you. Happy Diwali to all our listeners. Yes.